So this is a ultraviolet pen to disinfect water. These are the water sensors. As soon as it hits the water, the light bulb comes on. Maybe you can see the ultraviolet light glowing in there. If you get the smiley face, it's because things went well. Now it's safe to drink. So how long did that take? That took about 1 minute. And it cost me nothing but a little bit of battery. So this is a great solution for all the trekkers and bushcrafters, you know. Imagine in someone's property, they don't want you making fire, but you need to drink and you need to disinfect water. I would get one of these. SteriPen Ultra is the one I have. I only have good things to say about it. I've never gotten sick from any water source that I've collected and disinfected with this. Well, basically it does what it says it will. And I like that. Nice and simple. Make some tea after. On one of the last episodes, someone asked me where I found the stones for my fire. And I said they were not river stones. So I want to show you where I got my stones from. With very minimal effort. I'd say that the only effort I had really was to carry them. I didn't really have to dig them. What you want to look for is an uprooted tree, like a spruce or Scots pine, like this one. And here are your stones. The earth has done all the work for you. As long as it's not winter, they're not going to be stuck. If it's in winter, and that's why I waited so long, the soil would be frozen and it would be a pain in the butt to get these out. Right now that it's mid-spring, you can see that they come out very easily. It's a good place also to look for worms. If you're looking for spruce roots, this is another way to gather them. As you can see, I'm going to need a digging stick. And you can find all sorts of lens, you just have to dig it out. But it's a good starting point. There, just wanted to show you guys that. Nature supermarket. I've been looking for feathers everywhere for about 2 weeks. And haven't had much luck until now. Just wanted to show you that nature does provide, always. If you let it. I think an animal was killed and eaten right there. And I can see feathers from here. Maybe they're not the best feathers for what I want, but I'm sure I'll be able to use them for something. And here's the little bit of leftover. A little tiny bone with some blood. Maybe a badger or a fox just had a feast up here. Very little leftovers. Talk about not wasting anything. Well, I'm happy because I'm not one to waste stuff either. Told you this bag was handy. Not bad for a dollar. Look what we found, boy. Bunch of feathers. You sniff? You gonna eat the feather? You're funny. All sorts of feathers, but these winged ones and tail ones are the best for what I want. Look at that. to them too. And plumes. Look a little. No, don't mind. Oh, whoever ate this ate everything. Finished, brother. Look at that. That's a bonus. Pocket. I usually carry that cup that you just saw and that packable bag, nylon bag. And I also, starting from spring and until the winter or until late fall, I bring my anti-mosquito kit, head net. I also use natural made ones, but if those don't work as long, if there's a lot or maybe too many mosquitoes, then I use this. These clothes also are pretty much mosquito proof, so I only have to use it on my hands, on my face, and that's pretty much it. And even on my face, sometimes I prefer to just, you know, this head net is great. Use it like this. You can put your arms around like so, so it creates a good seal. The hat helps the net stay out of your face, which can be annoying. Looks a bit stupid, but it really does work. Don't have to also tell you that this is a wasp and bee proof. If you're going through an area with beehives, it's good to have this also. You know, it's more than once I've stumbled on a wasp's nest, and it was good to have this. And leather gloves. I found this horn a couple of weeks ago from a cow. Thinking of making some sort of hanger with it. So I've been fixing a little bit, been hanging some of my things, put a couple of little pegs here, just trying to organize the house. someone asked me how to make kindling. Keep making smaller and smaller pieces. It's not much to it. Try and follow the grain. Easier to split. And then make a variety of a pencil thickness to finger thickness to thumb thickness to wrist. And that's all you need. So yeah, it looks like it's bought in the shop, but it's not. I make it myself. It's just that I'm very neat with things like this. I put this part here against the wood and the blade right at the tip. Like this, it doesn't bite your hand when you hammer it, when you whack it down, like so. See? If you have it otherwise, it's gonna catch your fingers and it's gonna hurt a lot. And you don't need to go here, you can go just right at the edge. It's easier. Bring the axe slowly towards you and just turn it like so. Again, look. I really enjoy making kindling. And I don't know, I've lost count of how many tons I've probably chopped already. Maybe not tons, but yeah, maybe actually. Following the grain. And here, 5 minutes work. Okay, maybe 10 minutes. Bunch of kindling. Never been easier to start a fire in this camp. Plenty of tinder on the floor. There's gonna be a lot of crackling with this type of fuel. The only problem with pine or spruce is that it burns really fast. But again, it's fire, it works. It can be fussy. Oh, but it's lovely. Super warm. The reason why I try to avoid spruce and pine as much as I can, it's that. Those fire sparks flying around. Especially now, we're in the spring. The temperatures are gonna get warmer. There's gonna be a bigger forest fire risk. So then it's really good to just use hardwoods for a fire if you can find. They don't do all this fire spark shower. The one thing I love about using this wood for a fire is the actual sound of the crackling and these sparks. It's your typical campfire. This is a great sound to fall asleep to. Pedgeth, how are you? You look really grumpy. Are you cold? Stove's on. You can't be cold. It's raining a lot. And in days like this, it feels so good to have the fire stove on and just to do things inside the tipi. I'm not going outside until it stops. Way too windy, way too cold, way too yuck. Yuck, yuck.
You're not drinking enough water, so I'm gonna put it on water and you're gonna have to drink it like a soup. Oh, look, this is all metal. Maybe you can heat up your water a little bit. So how hungry are you? Hungry enough to fish for your food? Crap, one of them fell here. That's not good. It becomes mice food. Little bastards.
What about stinky sock soup? Actually, it's not stinky at all because I washed them. Yeah, we're not stinky here, even though it might look a little stinky. I gotta show you guys how I wash my clothes. Maybe a little more. It works. The water is not frozen.
There you go, brother.
Food. Not convinced?
Look at that spider.
It's like neon green. I haven't seen that one in the winter at all. Must be a spring spider. It only comes out in the spring. It's coming towards my foot. My foot? My foot. He wants to be served in bed with a spoon. He wants to be fed with a spoon. Now talk about spoiled. Come on, King Petrus, eat up. See, you're just making a mess. You can't be serious, man. You've never done this before. Here, eat your food. I think what's happened is that he's too comfortable and cozy in his bed. He didn't want to move at all.
You're getting spoiled, huh? Breakfast in bed.
I haven't seen a mouse for at least a month on one of these. And fortunately, I didn't kill that many because I always felt bad for the little fellas. This trap killed 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I tried everything. Being very careful when I was eating inside the teepee not to attract them inside. Nothing worked. And the reason why is because they weren't coming here just for food. They wanted to nest inside the teepee because it was always warm, obviously. They're clever. And, you know, some could say, well, they're just harmless little mice. Why didn't you live with them? Well, I don't know if you've ever seen what a mice can do to a wool blanket or clothes in a matter of minutes. They deserve to live like everybody else, but, you know, I can't have my stuff destroyed because then, if you would let that happen, You'd have no clothes and you'd die of hypothermia. Simple as that. Did I eat the mice? No. Did Petras eat the mice? No. Here comes the rain. So I got a new package from Thrunite, which is one of our sponsors. They make flashlights. By the way, this is not a review. I don't review products unless I test them for months. Wow. This is solid. Even though it's not nighttime now, you guys wanna see if this is bright? Let's check this out. Okay, so that's low. That's medium, and that's high. Okay. I don't know if you guys can see the difference, but this is not even the 7,500 lumens, I don't think. No. This is 2,500 lumens. Oh man, I wish I had that. This is amazing. Anyway, turn it off. I'm gonna put my Thrunite, which I thought it was bright, on max. 3, 4, 5. Okay, so this is what, 1,050 lumens, if I'm not mistaken. And I mean, this is bright enough. And I could paint with this light, but still, I needed at least two more to have the ideal light to film in here. So this is just a high, 2,500 lumens compared to this, look. Okay. You see the smile? Double click for turbo, which is 7,000. What? Holy cuckaloodum. 7,300 lumens. Okay, I'm curious. It's gonna be like heaven comes down here and goes, ah! 1, 2. Holy crap. Wow, I can open my eyes. It's like a truck headlight in your face. Will you look at that? That's high. Turbo. Oh my god. Yeah, it's like the sun just came in. I mean, you don't need 7,300 lumens to film and paint here. I think 2,500 is more than enough, but it's fun to have it. If you dog sledding, this would be perfect. Forget headlights. Attach this to your sled, and you're in business. I love the firefly mode. Perfect. Perfect reading light. Thanks a lot, Thrunite. I'm gonna make a brunch dish, breakfast lunch dish that I called Brag, which is bread mixed with egg. Not bragging, brag. If you don't have butter and you don't feel like having a very dry bread because you have nothing to put on it, the brag is perfect for that. What do you say, boy? Looks good? I think so. Ready for the next one. I have a pouch for my frying pan. It's a little heavy, but it's perfect. You know, these things usually fill up with soot, especially if you use a pine or a spruce to cook with. It gets really black and sooty. And you don't want that in your backpack. So I made this bag. And there's nothing to it. I just cut off one of my jeans. It was an old pair of jeans, and this is part of the leg. I cut it off on the top and the bottom, sewed it up at the bottom only, and sewed it here, put a little bit of paracord. Very bad sewing, as you can see. I can do better than this, but excuses, this was made on a rush. You know what, it's not so bad. Here's a good little bit of stitching, but it needs to be redone. And this is where I keep my frying pan. Another backpack cooking utensils. Is that how you say it? Utensils? I don't know. So yeah, my frying pans, usually they don't see soap at all. They might see a little bit of steel wool and hot water, ash, sand, but no soap. I want the oils to stay on them. My spork and plate, yeah, they usually see soap. The olive oil that stays here on these as much as possible also, because it preserves them. It's made of birch wood and it does need to be oiled from time to time. See, now it has a nice little sheen. I do understand that most people find this gross. Not most people, but some people. Not the outdoor folk. I think those guys and girls, they'll pretty much be with me on this one. But people that aren't used to camping or being outdoors and are used to washing machine and things like that, you're probably gonna get a little grossed out. But yeah, this is as far as I cleaned the spatula. It has a nice sheen now. It really doesn't need soap. So the only thing that gets soap sometimes is this, but most of the times I'll just wash with hot water, a bit of ash, and it's enough. More than enough. You ready to eat, boy? See, I can touch this. It's not hot at all. Perfect for Petrus. You get half now and half later, boy. Otherwise, you're just gonna stare at me. Because you don't know the meaning of chewing. You just gulp it. You wanna gulp it? I have to hold it so you don't, yeah. Whoa, you chewed. That's good. Now you swallowed. You can get the rest later. One of my tomatoes fell. The joys of camping. This is kind of wobbly, so it's a dish that actually, if you have a fork and a knife, it's a lot easier to eat. But you can do it like this too. You should chew, Petrus, because you extend the pleasure like a billion times. I've tried to explain this to you, but you don't want to listen. He's like, yeah, whatever. Pine resin. I'm gonna make some pitch glue with this. Thank you. better way to debark a tree, or faster than this, I don't think. You can do it with a knife or with an axe, but that takes ages compared to this. It's really good and fun. I'm just gonna put this now just to have a look, get a feel on how it might look when it's done. Rustic crooked table coming along.
Good look for you, ball boy. Woof, woof. Where's the ball? Not the ball.
My wife just dropped off a package from the UK. Rosemary and Company Artist Brushes. Yay! Okay, this is great because my old brushes, they were getting pretty worn out. Careful here. Now that's a package. Dear Rick, I've enclosed the samples for you to enjoy. I'm sure you will. Please keep me in the loop with your posts and I'll be sure to share them. All the best, Simi. Thank you so much, Simi. I really appreciate it. How cool. I'm keeping this as a souvenir. You know, I wouldn't recommend this if I haven't tried this for years. I've been using them for, I'm not sure, I think longer than 2 years, and they're nothing short of amazing. And when I started getting other offers from other companies to try out their brushes, you know, I decided to contact Rosemary and Company because they were my favorite. And I thought, if I'm gonna get a sponsorship on brushes, you know, I prefer that it would be them, because for me they are the best in the world. These catalogs are free. If you want one of them, all you have to do is go to www.rosemaryandco.com and order one, and they'll ship it for free to your house. And they have pretty much all the brushes they produce. And the pictures here are real sizes, which really helps, you know? So what you see is what you get. So anyway, there's brushes for all types of painters, you know, from acrylic painters to oil painters, watercolor painters, you name it, it's all here. you have a lot. Like this, these are my favorite. And these ones too. Nice, look at that. Look at that. Anyway, guys, I highly recommend. But you know what? You don't have to believe me. Just try one or two brushes and you'll be hooked. What I like about these brushes mainly is this. Every single brush in Rosemary & Company is, you know, made by hand. You know, by a real human being, not a machine. For me, that sold me entirely. As soon as I heard about it, I was like, well, I gotta check that out. And yeah, let's support humans, not machines, come on. All right, let's see what we got here. Opa. Sweet. So what I have here is 11 brushes from the Series 279 long flats, Master's Choice. I don't use all of these plein air, so usually what I do is I'll take the larger sizes, like the 10 or the even numbers, like so, 6, 4, 2, and 0, and then the odd numbers, I'll pack them together like that. So this gives me a set to use in the studio and one to use outdoors. The other thing you can do, if you prefer, is to use this, the even numbers for dark colors only and the odd numbers for light colors only. Some people like to do that. I don't really bother with that. I just clean my brush if I have to. Honestly, I just prefer to have one set for outdoor and save the rest for the studio. This is a rigger. Also Master's Choice, 273. And these I haven't tried yet. Master's Choice I've been using for a while now, a couple of years. But these are brand new. Ultimate Long Flat. So yeah, this is my oil setup. If you want to learn more about the brushes I use, you can go to nagualero.com/materials and I've listed everything I use there. Well, I just wanted to say once again, thank you so much, Sammy. You made my day. You've made my season. I really needed some new brushes. I was already contemplating using, you know, a little crazy over there. Get some of his hair for brushes, make my own brushes. But you came to the rescue, and I'd like to say thank you so much. And guys, try out these brushes. You will not regret it, my friends. Don't you just love the look of new brushes? It makes me drool. Perfect. Studio set, plein air set. Let's get to work. this is a self-constricting loop, like a lasso. As you can see, when you pull tension, it closes. And it grips really well. If you want to prevent this from happening, as I was hitting this with a mallet, you can see that it's mushrooming out and getting all destroyed here. That's because I was lazy. Usually what you do before you put the mallet in here, of course, and hit it, is you bevel the edges like so. And that prevents when you're hitting with a mallet, with a hammer or your axe, from, it prevents this from happening, what you just saw, which is basically this part getting mushroomed. Not a big deal though. The last time I put this tarp up, my cat touched it, just lightly touched it, and look what it did. The little creature teared a hole in a fraction of a second. So this is a good opportunity to show you how I fix this. This is what I'm looking for. You can find these in any camping store. Clean tape, removable, no residue, repair tape. So anyway, the hole is not even, it's half a centimeter wide. But the idea is I don't want it to stretch it. I don't want it to expand. Maybe now you can appreciate why I really want a working table here. It just makes things easier to build things. I'm trying to cut two identical pieces in size because one will be on top and one will be underneath the tarp. This so the hole becomes a thin slit. It's easier to start on top because then you have a reference guide when you go from below the tarp, because you'll be able to see the shadow or a difference in color. Making the edges round is, it's better. It prevents this from peeling off. I probably should have done that, but I'm being lazy here. Which means I'll probably have to redo this. Because when you're lazy, you do it twice. Just like when you buy cheap things, you end up buying twice. I don't know if you can see it or not, but now I can see the square, which is right here, which is easier for me now to match it from this side. So that's why I start from the outside and then I do the inside. Try not to hold the tips so it doesn't lose the glue. Again, you wouldn't have that problem if you cut it round. And there, problem solved. Now this is going to be my construction area with my table where I can build things. That's my chill out sunny deck or sun deck. That's where that hammock is. That's just my cooking shelter. And then I have my sleeping quarters. I understand if you only go out for a weekend once a year, or if you camp even only for a month, there's absolutely no need to build such a camp as this. But if you have land, or if you know someone that has land, maybe your family has a piece of land, And you'd like to have a permanent camp where you can go any time of the year, or you can spend several months there if you choose to do so. You'll see that having different compartments or areas is very handy, and you will appreciate, especially not when it's sunny, because then the whole world becomes your living room. But when it's super windy, when it's rainy, when the weather is not according to the gods, you know, of favor, you will appreciate having many other rooms. Who wants Tinder? Good boy. Yeah. Yeah. Super hot. Okay, that's a good. Go. Come on, go with it. You're gonna do it here, right? Come on, up, up. Good boy. Feel better? Here's an old file. I'm in a serious need of a crooked knife, so I'm going to make one. Glasses are so good that they actually protect my eyes from the smoke also. Not bad. I'm defining my edge now. Nothing too complicated. I'm keeping it as simple and as basic as possible. So what I did is I heated up the file and I beat it up into shape. Heating it makes the steel very soft. And because the steel is soft, I also use that as a chance to make the profile, or the blade profile. I don't know if you can see it or not, but it's pretty much done. But the more I'm filing, it's getting a huge amount of burr. What I'm gonna do now, it's pretty straight. I'm just gonna heat it up, make it soft again, make a slight upward edge, and maybe here in the handle, lift it up a little, because I think to hold it, instead of holding like so, hold it slightly in an angle, would probably be easier. I'd say. Maybe not, but I'm gonna try it anyways. This is my knife, I can do whatever. So, let's heat this up.
Okay, let's see. I should do.
Try and create a little upward edge here. Let's see if I can do this. Got a nice little crooked little bit here to help with some carving. I got about 10 centimeters of straight edge as a draw knife. That makes it hard, but brittle. If you try to bend this, it's a lot harder. It doesn't feel too brittle. It's definitely not soft. So I think I got a good thing going here. Gonna strop it a little bit, get rid of the burr. Now I'm gonna make a new handle, sharpen it a little more, make some finer details, and then I'll show you how it looks. These shavings, beautiful curls. It worked. A tool like this is great to shape wood, debark it, and a lot more. It's holding the edge pretty well. Can see still sharp. Not razor sharp yet, but believe me, I'll get there.